Thank you very much. My talk is called Lessons from the Rainforest. So I'm a soil scientist with the BC Forest Service, and I conduct research into some of the most fundamental questions we have in forest management: our long-term soil productivity, the conservation of our soils, and the ecosystem biodiversity associated with our soils. I have a lot of fun conducting field studies all over the west coast of BC in the hopes of improving our understanding of soils and passing that information on to forest management. As part of my mandate, I've been working in the coastal temperate rainforests of BC. And these are just some of the most impressive forests in the world. Really beautiful, long-lived, enormous trees like Douglas fir and Sitka spruce. And in addition to their beauty and the awesome of being out there, we recognize also that there's tremendous carbon storage in these stands, not just in the big trees, but also in the soils. Anytime I've dug soil pits out there, I've been very impressed by the organic matter. Quite often on the surface at the forest floor, you can have 10 or 20 centimeters of very dark, black organic matter, what we call humus. We only find that on the west side of the island. So there's a huge amount of carbon in these soils. And in the Forest Service, of course, we're very interested in carbon now. We used to worry about growing trees, but now more and more of our focus is on carbon. We want to keep that carbon in the ground and really help to try and mitigate some of these effects of climate change. So rainforests are called rainforests because of all the rain. Places like Tofino get 3 meters of rain. This has a great effect on soils. Here's an example of a dry forest soil pit near Victoria, where we don't get as much rain, like a meter of rain, and a wet forest site near Banfield, where we get 3 meters of rain. You can see a tremendous difference in colors. The dry soil is much more of a drab brown color. The wet soil is much more orange. So this suggests some pretty profound chemical change in these soils from thousands of years of heavy rain. And when I measure the carbon in these types of sites, I can find 2 to 3 times more carbon in that wet soil than in the dry forest. So this raises a very fundamental question. Why is there such a difference in carbon? Why is there so much carbon in those soils and not on this side of the island? Historically, the thinking behind this is that, one, rainforests don't burn down very often, so you don't burn off that carbon. And secondly, they're considered kind of cold. And so decomposition is slowed down and this organic matter accumulates. But when you think about this critically, it doesn't really make sense. One, there's actually quite a bit of evidence that First Nations burn forests all over the coast, so they're not perfectly disturbance-free. And two, they're not that cold. Mean annual temperature out there is about 8 or 9 degrees. So I have stuff go moldy in my fridge overnight, so I don't think it's a cold issue. So now there's an interesting new line of thinking coming up, and it has to do with fungi, the mushrooms we find in our forests every fall. Fungi are incredibly important to forest ecosystems because they produce enzymes. You might know enzymes, you've heard of enzymes, because our body produces enzymes to digest food. Well, fungi are the same, except they produce enzymes, they secrete it into the soil to get their food. And we eat fairly simple food, like fruit and vegetables. The fungi eat very complex food, like wood, or that organic matter I was showing earlier. So they produce a much more different suite of enzymes. And this raises a new and interesting perspective. So after all this rain and these chemical changes in the soil, in the rainforest, we notice that there's a change in some of the important nutrients in those soils. One of them is called manganese. And the mycologists have told us that manganese is a critical part of these enzymes. The fungi need manganese to make these enzymes to break down organic matter. And so we've been finding, I have a data set from Vancouver Island, and there's another data set from Sweden, and we find this really nice inverse correlation. The less manganese you have in your soil, the more carbon you have in your soil. And so the thinking is, without manganese, these fungi cannot produce enzymes, to the point where these fungi aren't even in the stands anymore. And I've been out on the west side now for the last 3 falls, walking and looking for these mushrooms. And some of the most common species you find around Victoria, you cannot find over there. And I have looked under every sword fern and salal. It's remarkable how few of these fungi you can find in the rainforest, which doesn't make a lot of sense because there's all this rain, and they love rain, and there's all this carbon, which is food. Where are these fungi? And so our thinking is, without that manganese, this fungal ecosystem, this fungal biota has gone away. Of course, we're talking about a correlation. Correlation can be a little bit dangerous. You have to be sure about cause and effect. So I've been looking at enzyme activity across the island this last summer, and I am finding quite a nice decline from the east to the west side as you get into these rainforests, a decline in a lot of these key enzymes. I've also collected soils and put them in jars in the lab, and I've added manganese to see if I can stimulate this enzyme production and show that it's truly the cause of this carbon. So there's still lots of work to do, lots of things to sort out. But I chose this topic today because I think it illustrates nicely kind of the work that we do in the Forest Service. Carbon cycle could not be a more fundamental part of our understanding of forest ecology, and yet we're still discovering new things, asking new questions here in 2019. You might have thought the carbon cycle was kind of done. It's in a textbook. We don't have to think about it anymore. I would argue that's not true. So that's been kind of fun. And of course, the implications are enormous because we manage a huge land base, and anything we can do to, at the very least, keep that carbon in the soil or maybe even boost carbon sequestration would be a great way to pull some of that carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, get it into the ground where it's not doing so much harm. So the management implications are very profound, and we continue to build upon our understanding of the carbon cycle. I call this talk Lessons from the Rainforest also because it also illustrates the work that we do in government. We are out in the woods all the time, hot, dry, wet, cold. We spend time in these ecosystems. If you're going to manage the land base, you have to spend time on that land base to really understand what's going on. And the other nice thing about working with the Forest Service is we have these research forests and these long-term installations and studies, so we have a tremendous investment in the research capacity. So people like me can use those sites to compare and contrast ecosystems and understand how processes differ from one side to the other, you know, between these sort of abiotic gradients. And that's a really powerful tool to try and garner our understanding of forest ecosystems. And with any luck, you'll stumble upon some weird nugget like manganese drives carbon sequestration. And if it's true, pass that along to our forest managers and do a better job of managing our forests sustainably. Thank you.